welcome to Sheldopedia. It is Sheldon Betteridge here on today's show. We'll be discussing about Chris Rockson's first question as a leader of the opposition. I'm gonna tell you for government about what government it would have been achieved after I play the first song of the day, which is. What does It is Infinity by James Young on Sheldopedia on Arrow FM.
Love, I'll never let it die. Can't be touched by no one. I like to see them try.
Oh,
Paris Infinity by James Young on Sheldopedia on Arrow EVM. You was only a one way to paradise, because the luxus fears outed and question as a success. But private in the older days, a strongest condition makes everyone better. It's also strongest performance in the house by Jason Arden for a long period. The primers are unlikely to care. Literally, Grant Robertson and Grosser can start to seem to love the house instead. It is something to take in seriously, mostly endured and occasionally enjoyed. And let's be honest, the primaries and senior ministers have been cleared darling in the form most of year against a weak opposition. I didn't shout on Tuesday that she caught plenty of extra of gears that she caught kicking when needed. But back to Luxon, where his first out he was most assured and contracted on the government and invested in ICUBs as well, asking the EG Dutchies were questions in plain English. For the bug, his only answered a handful of questions in the house. Prior to this, it was very good. Early on, he teetered a bit, stumbling, losing his way in the questions, stumbling when asking about sending COVID money on the wild because. In the house, we've ever before this special or question are important. Research to meet our affairs like go fight and fly and compete as fast as unlikely. Luxor will let himself make too many more. Ready in a week since he was selected, he has significantly died out of corporate that he can be inclined to slow when he speaks for too long. And he was rearing to go, gripping into a side of a seat in the debating chamber, ready to jump a float and pepper for Prime Minister with questions. And the house is somewhat obscured this by a couple of factors. The first is set on the house, fed on Tuesday if the house was full for the first time since before Delta arrived in these shores. That bite gives a lustre of atmosphere, been missing in this past month, leading a good blow to the full debate. Japan's far more in the family, even behind the social distance in a nearly deserted room. The second reason is that at the top of Collins, over Collins' year and a half, general forgettableness of a short Miller leadership and everything will be seen to be good by comparison. Fancy better is better, even if what became before it was poor, it was undoubtedly returning fighting and enjoyed performance for front bench did not look fresh. Some in label circles were curious about why there is such emphasis on ICU capacity. When based about here, it was that with our Russians, questions should be for about 40 staff ICU beds, so otherwise unable to dodge a question by putting herself out of the issue was not beds, not staff. For reason was for the concentration was this. If it is to cover a pinch point for the government's COVID response that requires fever lockdowns and restrictions, it will be likely to be a result of hospitals that have been unable to cope with COVID cases coming through the door. That means a crunch on ICU capacity. There's no evidence there will be a case of, at this point, But it does set up a potential line of attack in the new year. Should it again, if it doesn't, no harm, no foul, and good for New Zealand's toes to move on to a private government on something else. Here's with his strong performances, but pointed by Luxon's Deputy Nicola Willis and Simon Bridges. Bridges just as a success parliamentarian, he came in the parliament at Southside. For the same year, it is now appointed Minister of Finance Grant Robertson. Bridges home to the cost of living and Kiwis going backwards. Robertson responded his ultra low of employment widening and SMB global credit. Ratings upgrade each bad critical after whipping out their policy trades with boost the arguments. Question time was also essentially reminded in Luxon that David Seymour will find his sights on the right end of the surgery, given another strong performance bailing up the Prime Minister for various alleged failures to the ICU and inflation. In the past few months, Seymour has also been de facto leader of a surgeon of the House and the Colonel fighting to keep it that way. One fact short, it was a revitalized nation which pushed some ministers. This idea comes up for the first time in a year in the early days, it should be overstated whenever it can be maintained is another matter, but all things in competition is healthy at best. Governor may finally have some in Parliament. This is a clip from Parliament TV. Yeah, Prime Minister Sheldon and leader also criticised clash over each of the intensive guests. Sheldon Larkin's first question time as a leader of the opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Prime Minister and reads, does she stand by all of her government's statements and actions?
Be right on the Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, may I begin by congratulating the member on his new role? Mr. Speaker, yes. In particular, I stand by this government's ongoing successful response to the COVID-19 pandemic, that for the past 2 years has seen New Zealand have the lowest cumulative number of cases, hospitalisations and deaths per capita in the OECD. And now we can add extraordinarily high vaccination rates as well. At the same time, our economy has continued to perform with record low levels of unemployment, high economic growth and some of the longest stretches without restrictions of any comparable country. Mr. Speaker, over the past 2 years, this government and New Zealand has provided a strong response to a global pandemic that continues. It, of course, hasn't been easy, but the results tell the country story. That is why I proudly stand by this government's statements and actions.
Yeah.
Why did her government spend more than $50 billion from its COVID fund before announcing any funding for extra ICU beds?
Mr. Speaker, well, I reject that question. Mr. Speaker, what we know, one of the most important things that need to be provided are not just the beds, but the staffing of the beds. Five nurses are required for every ICU. Five ICU nurses are required per bed. So not only have we got a 300 ICU or high dependency unit beds and the ability to surge to 500, we put aside funding in the budget to ensure that we could train the staff required for the additional beds that we have.
Does she agree why did her government choose to prioritise things like eradicating wallabies, including a pandemic, over increasing the number of fully staffed ICU beds?
Mr. Speaker, again, I reject the premise of the member's question. So not only did we increase the amount of money that went into training our ICU staff, because that is the critical piece of the puzzle, we also have, of course, put in capital expenditure for ICU physical space as well. $10 million into the expansion of Tauranga's ICU space, new ICU facility at Waitakere, 12 additional beds in Canterbury, and in addition to the training that we've provided for ICU nurses, $544 million for the operational spending of staffing for those new beds. But Mr. Speaker, the one thing I would say, our focus has been ensuring people don't end up in ICU the first place. We want to save lives, not have a situation where people are critically unwell.
David Seymour.
If the problem with staffing more ICU beds was getting the nurses, why did it take until the 20th of October for the government to set aside MIQ space for nurses coming to look after those Kiwis she cares so much about?
Mr. Speaker, that is not true, first of all. Second of all, Mr. Speaker, as I said, the funding for the additional staff was right at the beginning of the pandemic. Second point, if you only rely on surge capacity, that is what happened in the UK. When you have ICU staff who come in to support a surge, an overwhelming of a health workforce, the death rate in ICU increases. Our goal has always been to stop that from occurring. If you are overwhelmed in a pandemic, people die, no matter how many staff you have.
A point of order, David Seymour.
Mr. Speaker, my question was very specific about MIQ, not about funding and not about the nature of staff, whether they were organised as surge staff, but about MIQ capacity and when it was announced. She did not address that at all.
Order. Order. The member started his question that way. Unfortunately, it had a tail, which it opened it up for the answer.
Mr. Luxon.
So why did Wellington ICU specialist Dr. Paul Young say recently, quote, "I challenge you to visit any ICU in the country and find one clinician, just one, who can show you their newly staffed ICU beds"?
Mr. Speaker, as I've said, we have increased the support and funding for ICU staff. We've put an extra $100 million into capital funding for ICU beds. But, Mr. Speaker, ultimately our goal has been not to put pressure on that part of the system. At the peak of this outbreak, my recollection is that we've had 11 people in ICU. We have had capacity throughout the pandemic in our ICUs. We've had surge capacity of an additional 200 beds. But if you, Mr. Speaker, the member's goal is to simply have capacity, open up and flood the ICU, we have a very different view of pandemic management.
At any point in the first 12 months of the pandemic, did she actually pick up the phone and instruct her health minister to increase the number of fully staffed ICU beds? If so, when?
Mr. Speaker, I've said multiple times now that part of our pandemic response, of course, has been about enabling not just physical beds, but the capability and capacity to properly staff them. You can convert a ward, Mr. Speaker, but you need the qualified staff in order to operate it in a way that people do not die. We have funded that. Mr. Speaker, though, again, I come back to the point. Throughout this pandemic, our issue has not been pressure on our ICU.
That's right.
Our focus has been on making sure we don't have outbreaks that overwhelm our ICU.
Yeah, yeah.
If we at any point got to that level, it would mean contact tracing would have fallen over. It would have meant our public health units would be overwhelmed. It would have meant we would have been like many other countries, and we have not been.
Why did it take her 21 months to announce additional funding for ICU beds when during the same time New South Wales was able to double their ICU capacity?
Mr. Speaker, if the member wishes to compare us to a state that had 75,000 cases, when the state of Victoria was setting up infrastructure in its car parks, then that is the member's prerogative. I think what it demonstrates is, so no matter what your surge capacity is or your ICU beds, if you are overwhelmed, you are overwhelmed. No country in the world had capacity that allowed themselves to save people's lives if their ICU were overwhelmed. That has never been our goal. We had a different strategy.
What does she say to the viaduct business owners I spoke with last week, who are utterly confused by her traffic light framework, which suggests that they should already be at green? And when will she finally tell them what actually is the criteria for a colour change?
Before that happens, I've asked the site. It's
well, I have to leave it there. So let's get on to the new song. To the next song, which is It Will Be Okay by Shawn Mendes. The song is about the breakup of Camila Cabello.
Are we gonna make it? Is this gonna hurt? Oh, we can try to sedate it, but that never works. Yeah. I start to imagine a world where we don't collide. It's making me sick, but we'll heal and the sun will rise. If you tell me you're leaving, I'll make it easy. It'll be stop the bleeding. We don't have to fix it. We don't have to stay. I will love you either way.
It'll be okay, Rachel Minis on Sheldopedia on Arrow FM. A new COVID variant of Omicron has emerged as ever, everything like a flu. We'll have to see new mutations of coronavirus nearly every year. We'll require new vaccine shots. And we're going back into level 4 lockdowns at a police checkpoint locking up large house of a country. every time when a new variant emerges, all cattle give it a guarantee which days are over. And MPH side of health concern first, otherwise library and people unaware. Omicron is a cause of concern, but not for paddocks. As the pandemic began, we know about the risk posed by new variants. Afterwards, we are primarily concerned with Delta, and now Omicron has emerged with variant of concern. Our understanding of whether Omicron variant is still very much in infancy is not yet clear. Whenever Omicron is more transmittable or causes more severe disease than other variants, case numbers through the parts of South Africa affected by this variant. Now which are now seeing over 3,000 cases per day, and it'll keep on rising. But studies are underway to determine if it's actually because of Omicron. Primary data shows increasing hospitalization rates in South Africa, but this may be due to rising case numbers, like I tell you earlier. Researchers around the world are working hard to better with many aspects of Omicron and will continue to find any severe findings, including the potential impact of a variant on vaccine effectiveness. Vaccine is central to the next phase of COVID-19 response, and New Zealand is coming to forward to get vaccinated. So I can take everything they caught on IVF is very seriously. But 4-3 for Waitemata, Auckland, Capital and Coast, and Canterbury, DHBs have been 90% fully vaccinated. Southern DHB will coming up next with 89% vaccination. The government has taken a precautionary approach and restricted travel from 9 Southern African countries where Omicron is out of control. We are treating South Africa, Namibia, Zimbabwe, Botswana, Lesotho, Eswatini, Seychelles, Malawi, Mozambique as very high risk countries to reduce the chance of Omicron entering New Zealand. Given an evolving situation, our cautious approach, we wanted indicators of very high risk register is an proportional measure as we gather more information. Very New Zealand remains in very good position to keep its variant out and contain any causes and border strict protocols, and our managed social velocities, frequencies of arrivals continue to serve us well. For now, our third border settings remain in place. We are not starting the EFOs until mid-January and realize the basis of under constant review. We continue to take a cautious approach and lock in our gates of approach to progress and assumption of missover approval for wild to Pfizer dose for young children will add to this. But government COVID-19 protection frameworks is still powerful to our greater freedoms through vaccination, helping us save and move away from lockdowns as our primary defense. We have one of the highest vaccination rates in the world, and vaccine news are deserved to be awarded for that this summer. Because while we aren't vaccinated, have face restriction likely to in level 4 lockdown down twice. And previously, before the Delta outbreak, New Zealand vaccination rates was pretty low alongside Australia. With UK years now ahead since the Delta began, now we're among the highest vaccinated countries across and Australia and New Zealand too. Look in the Australia Territory of the ACT Australia Capital Territory. They had over 95% fully vaccinated. While West Australia is the least vaccinated, said only 68% fully vaccinated amid a fresh new outbreak in South Australia. Seriously, National MP for Kai Kura, what does public health expert first provide advice on New Zealand's COVID-19 response seems to fail to understand this, that lockdowns come at a huge cost to society, not only the likes of hospitality and tourism sectors, only needs, but the mental strain and tolls on lockdowns cannot be underestimated. And that is reality we won't know for quite some time. In fact, we are consequences of those lockdowns and the impact it has been on health and well-being. How many people will suffer from delayed cancer diagnosis and for treatment? Probably more people die from cancer. No doubt, well, some will die prematurely as a result of this. How many have they suffered and pain from delayed elective surgery as a regular strata over fever. For home confirmed matters, he lies all right, visit appears to be mild if increased period, and where does a new virus continue to emerge, viruses change and adapt over time. Fortunately, for new MRA effects that will also be quickly altered, could cover for new variants. This has been a not an individual may be on decision about when they want to be vaccinated or not. We say that National MP Sheldon Smith downplays severity on Omicron.
So what does it all mean for New Zealand? I spoke earlier to the COVID-19 Response Minister, Chris Hipkins, who told me it's inevitable that Omicron will show up in our MIQ facilities.
Most of those countries around the world who are moving very fast are re-establishing the protections that we still have in place. So many of those countries removed their border restrictions and the things that we haven't done yet. We signalled that we were going to do that in January, February. Of course, the worst case scenario is that we may have to revisit that. It's still very early days yet, still too soon to be making those kind of predictions.
Yes, and the worry is that Delta got through somehow, through MIQ. So, if Omicron is even more transmissible, then the risk increases. Do you need to make any other measures to try and understand ways to prevent that slipping through?
I think if you look at the strength of our MIQ arrangements, they're some of the tightest in the world. Even other countries who have had border restrictions in place haven't had the degree of stringency that we have had here in New Zealand. The reality, though, is that we're dealing with a human virus. There's no way to be 100% foolproof, 100% protected. And so therefore, we will do what we can if we need to. But at this point, like I said, we've got a wee way to go before we're making those kind of calls.
You're adamant or you accept that it is likely to turn up in MIQ?
Oh, it's if you look at the way it's spread and how quickly it's spread, including to countries like Australia and the UK, it's inevitable that it will show up in our MIQ facilities at some point.
You were warned a lot about Delta, and the Brian Roche's review team and letter to you in September raised a number of concerns about the lack of preparedness for Delta. What lessons can be learned from that, and in particular, will you follow up his advice to set up an independent unit for dealing with the pandemic into the future?
One of the reasons that we've been reluctant to do a wholesale reorganisation of the people who are involved in the response is the level of disruption that would cause. And particularly, if we're finding ourselves in a phase where parts of our COVID-19 response will be winding down. So if you think about the border restrictions and so on, we're currently working towards a situation where many of those restrictions will be progressively removed early next year. So reorganising everybody that's been involved in them and creating new agencies that by the time you created them, in effect, wouldn't be needed, isn't something that we've been focused on doing. Now, of course, we've got to be prepared for the fact that things might change, and we are prepared for that. And if that's the case, then we'll relook at that.
The booster shot issue, I see the UK has moved to bring them forward. Australia is looking at it. Are you seeking advice on whether to bring booster shots forward to, say, 3 months as an extra precaution against new variants?
Well, at the moment, we've started to roll out the booster shots for those who had their vaccines over 6 months ago. Those numbers are really starting to ramp up on a daily basis. I think we did about 22,000 booster shots yesterday. Many of those other countries that are reviewing their booster shots have been doing them on a more targeted basis. We haven't been targeting them. We've basically been saying everybody can get them after 6 months. And so, of course, we keep that under review, though. And if the science tells us that it's worth moving sooner, then we'll certainly be looking at that.
And have we got the supply to be able to do that?
Yeah, we've got plentiful supply of vaccines at the moment. There's nothing to prevent us doing more if we needed to do that.
We're seeing the vaccine manufacturers saying they're already working on new vaccines, potentially for this new variant or others. What is our sort of long-standing position in terms of being ready to purchase new vaccines if need be?
We're in the market every day, continuing to talk to the suppliers, and we've already had conversations with Pfizer about the new variants. They are reasonably confident that they can adapt their vaccine to new variants quite quickly, and we're certainly in the position that if that was to happen and we needed to purchase more vaccines that have been adapted and roll them out quickly, we're certainly in a position to be able to do that.
And that is the COVID-19 Response Minister, Chris Hipkins.
The fact of the matter is the majority of New Zealanders who are vaccinated should not be held to ransom by the minority who choose not to be. I am double vaccinated like any other New Zealanders. I trust the vaccine to do its job. I don't fear those who are not vaccinated that I should be over everyone for the other unvaccinated may be a choice and are prepared to accept the risk of reality of COVID-19 becoming a disease of our unvaccinated. If we end up locking ourselves down and have a fortress New Zealand, each time new variant emerges, the toll will be enormous. Of course, we need to be vigilant of new variants. It could be times where we need to be more cautious. We must be about to receive the effects, consider the cost of restricting the entire day as far as not been done to date. We cannot use restriction without any analysts because the towers take, while not fully understood yet, is undoubtedly being understated. New Zealand was one of the last countries to give the Delta variant of COVID-19, and yet the government said it has well spread throughout the other countries without planning it to arrive in New Zealand. Whilst Omicron was the early stage of the government measures with hundreds of millions of dollars in resources, New the government had to avoid lockdowns and restrictions as new variants arise. New Zealand has done the highest in blocking out COVID-19. A true cost won't be noticed, as we should have to go through this when over. I have obviously been fully vaccinated. What? But we can live with Omicron, just like the Delta variant. Because Omicron variant had reportedly spread across the 10 states, while Delta variant is still prominent. Right now, the next song I will be playing is... I dance throwback to 2006's Yeah Yeah by Body Rocks.
You think you got it all worked out?
Right, Fiza criticised former South African president about rationalising creatine health efforts. Just like in El Spring, Victoria in 1991.
One variant in Senegal starts here at a health centre in downtown Dakar where doses of the COVID-19 vaccines are available.
It's not because we have a vaccine that we're immune. We need to keep protective measures and protect those around us. It's not over.
At a two-day peace and security forum held in Dakar on Monday, South Africa's president Cyril Ramaphosa accused rich countries of creating health apartheid.
I have personally really been disappointed in the approach that the rich countries have taken on the issue of vaccines. Firstly, they hoarded vaccines. They ordered more vaccines than their populations required. And when we wanted vaccines, they just kept, you know, giving us the crumbs from their table. And the greed that they demonstrated is something that is quite, quite disappointing indeed. Particularly when they say they are our partners.
The pandemic overshadowed the 7th Peace and Security Forum held here, which welcomed heads of state, intelligence officers, and military chiefs. Usually, discussions at the forum revolves around greater military cooperation between Western nations and African countries. But with Western countries breaking their promise to supply vaccines and their unwillingness to waive patents to allow people here to make their own, trust is eroding, with some nations looking at new partnerships. To help the fight against COVID in Africa, China announced it's sending 1 billion doses of vaccines. On the fight against armed groups in the Sahel region, Niger's president admitted that Al-Qaeda affiliates are in some places better equipped than the security forces of some countries in West Africa. Following increased attacks, Mali is seeking help from the Russian mercenaries working for Wagner, the private military company.
That's why countries like Mali, we have decided to go more and more for diversification of our partnerships. We can work with China, we can work with Russia.
Also at the forum, delegates from Western nations reiterated their goodwill and intentions. But countries such as South Africa and Senegal say that's not good enough. Vaccines made in Africa, for Africans, is what they want. Almost a quarter of a million Africans are reported to have died of the virus so far. The message here is those deaths were preventable if only victims had access to vaccines. Nicholas Hawk, Al Jazeera, Dakar.
Africa should have more vaccine available choices to boost up the vaccination rates, because we don't want any more variants of COVID emerged throughout the year. What will happen is Omicron been spreading very rapidly at the moment. Next song I will be playing is It is that thing. It will be Pumped Up by Indo, and Elsa James is up next.
You've got to pump it up, don't you know, pump it up. You've got to pump it up, don't you know, pump it up. You've got to pump it up, don't you know, pump it up. You've got to pump it up, don't you know, pump it up. You've got to pump it up, don't you know, pump it up. You've got to pump it up, don't you know. You got to pump it up, don't you know?
got to pump it up, don't you know, pump it up. You got to pump it up, don't you know, pump it up. You got to pump it up, don't you know, pump it up. You got to pump it up, 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 up.
That was Pump It Up, Bayan Dua on Sheldopedia on Arrow EV. Right now is Worship by Alice in Chains. That was roasted by Alice and Chains on Sheldopedia on Error FM. New is this what America suffered here. New COVID cases increased significantly last week, surpassing an average of 100,000 cases per day in the United States. Deaths are also on the rise, averaging more than 1,000 per day. Because the concern that Omicron variant will might see in a large amount of cases and loss of life, as even with last Saturday, as Omicron variant now sweeping through the USA. According to the CDC, the disease control provision, new COVID-19 cases in our city, about 100,000 a day, about 7,000 more than last week. Michigan has the most hospitalizations, with 43,000 being hospitalized for COVID-19. With only 53 counties recording low transmission rate, with 1.64% community rate. With Florida, with its also seeing the least transmission, in California, see not as much as community transmission as it hoped. But all of New England and of the Midwest and Arizona recording high community transmission. And over most cities, everywhere, New York has the most new cases in 7 days, with 6,551 new positive tests. Ohio City with 33,560 cases in the past week, with Pennsylvania way behind with 30,549 new cases. These are promises, and the fate of the day is George Washington's only U.S. president to have received 100% of electoral votes. Well, I have not got time for another song, so that's it for Sheldopedia. I'll see you next Wednesday. Bye.